Welcome, everyone. My name is Dr. Laura Cullen, and I'm the Executive Director of the Harriet and Kenneth Kupferberg Holocaust Center at Queensborough Community College in Bayside, New York. Our mission is to use the lessons of the Holocaust to educate current and future generations about the ramifications of prejudice, racism, and stereotyping. Today's talk is entitled Women in the Nazi Concentration Camps, featuring Dr. Azadeh Alai. Following Dr. Alai's talk, we'll also take a special look at the KHC's virtual exhibition, The Concentration Camps, Inside the Nazi System of Incarceration and Genocide. After today's talk, please be sure to submit your questions via the Q&A feature on your screen. Now, it's my great pleasure to introduce Dr. Azadeh Alai. Dr. Alai is assistant professor with tenure of psychology at Queensborough Community College at the City University of New York. Her research interests currently focus on Holocaust education and the psychology of bystander behavior during the Holocaust. Her past research has focused on the intersection of media, mass violence, warfare, and genocide. She is the author of Understanding Aggression, Psychological Origins and Approaches to Aggressive Behavior, as well as was the scholar in residence for the 2017 Kupferberg Holocaust Center National Endowment for the Humanities Colloquium entitled Collaboration and Complicity. Dr. Alai, we're very excited to welcome you today.
Hi, thank you so much for that great introduction. I'm so happy to be here. So I'm just going to dive right in because I know that we don't have that much time and there were a lot of things that I wanted to cover. So thank you so much for taking time out of your afternoon today to join us for this event. I find that it can be overwhelming when we try to wrap our heads around all the different types of ways that Jewish people and other targeted groups were persecuted during the Holocaust. And one of the ways that we can potentially make the topic more manageable is to select a theoretical orientation or an approach to kind of understand what the victims and other players under the regime were experiencing. And, you know, I'm just using the term players, actors, for lack of a better word, people, you know. So, okay, let's do a brief overview of just basic terms. I want to make sure that we're all on the same page regarding language that I'm going to be using. So the terms sex and gender are oftentimes used interchangeably, and they have a lot of important connections with one another, but they actually have very distinct meanings that I want to make sure that I convey. So sex is a biological construct. When we are identifying the sex of the person, this is the kind of anatomical, chromosomal, genetic features that differentiate men from women. And as an extension of sex, we have sex roles that are essentially the reproductive capabilities or limitations biologically of each respective sex. So sex and sex roles is a very biologically based construct. Gender, on the other hand, is a environmental or nurture-based construct. Gender is the social, the psychological, the cultural meanings behind being a man or being a woman. And as an extension of that, we have gender roles or norms, which is essentially what is deemed within a society or culture appropriate behaviors for one sex versus the other. And so, for instance, if we apply this to the Nazi regime, let's say, then the question becomes, what did it mean to be a Jewish man or woman living in Nazi Germany or occupied territories this time? Or more generally, what did it mean to be a female bystander potentially versus a male bystander or perpetrator, et cetera? And it's important to kind of recognize the potential influences of sex and gender, because research finds that sex and gender, it's like this overarching cognitive framework that enables us to give meaning to our lives and to and it influences how we interpret or perceive the world around us, particularly in social contexts. So for instance, the research finds that actually there are three factors when we're approached by somebody new that are triggered in terms of characteristics we're trying to figure out about that person. The first factor is age. We also want to figure out their sex or gender, and then finally their race or ethnicity. And age and sex and gender are believed to be kind of evolutionary based triggers, because this is information that can help me determine whether or not someone is a potential threat to me. And then race or ethnicity is a byproduct of how we're socialized, because in virtually all societies, we're socialized to make categorizations based on constructions of race or ethnicity. So if we take a look specifically at the Nazi ideology during this time period, and I'll just offer a really kind of brief description of this. I remember when I was participating in a seminar at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum in Washington, D.C., the director of the program kind of reduced down Nazi policy to this mantra of race and space. And it always stayed with me because it's such a quick and efficient way to kind of understand the ideology, but essentially the idea that's put forth within this regime by the architects, including Hitler, is this idea of this kind of superiority of the quote-unquote German race or the Aryans, if you will. And so the Nazi regime kind of constructs on a systemic or institutional level this new kind of racial order, if you will, or socially constructed hierarchy, where Germans or this Aryan race is at the top of that hierarchy. And kind of embedded within this ideology, anti-Jewish or anti-Semitism is embedded in this value system. And so Jewish people are placed like on the bottom of this hierarchy as, you know, the inferior race. And then based on this notion of kind of racial superiority or dominance, the Nazi ideology is that they need to create as much space as possible. So to expand as much as possible, you know, for agricultural purposes, to have more land to live on, for instance, and that as an expansion of this space, that these other groups that are currently in these territories will essentially be enslaved. Or in the case of the Jewish victims or other targeted groups, eventually the policy will escalate to this mass murder. And so this race, for those of you who have me for class, you're probably familiar with my dog. If I seem a little distracted, I've just been trying to make sure that he's well behaved during this talk. So within this kind of, within this race and space ideology, you can't really separate sex and gender, because essentially what happens is that men and women are going to be assigned different roles within this larger system. So for instance, German women were central to this ideology for Hitler. He's actually quoted as praising them as quote unquote, our most loyal, fanatical fellow combatants. And there's two aspects of German women that Hitler deems as particularly powerful or critical to this kind of overarching ideology or new world order, if you will. First is their biological power as generators of the master race. And that biological power is really a demonstration of the sex role, the reproductive role that women versus men play. And so a lot of pressure is placed on German women to basically become pregnant and to bear multiple children and things like that. But he also sees German women's power as playing a critical role in essentially facilitating activism within the Nazi movement itself. And I'll elaborate on that a little bit down the line. But there's this obvious kind of explicit collision between the racial policies and sex and gender, because within this system, men and women have different roles to fulfill. whether from the perspective of perpetrators as victims or potentially as rescuers or resistors, let's say, to this system. So for instance, just briefly, I wanted to share something. This is actually from the KHC online exhibit of the concentration camp system. So if you take a look, this is actually identifying the types and numbers of Nazi camps and ghettos between the periods of 1933 and 1945. And for our purposes right now, what I was really struck by the first time that I was exposed to this breakdown is of the 44,000 camps that would end up existing as this kind of large-scale concentration camp system. If you look near the bottom, 500 to 600 of them are identified as brothels. So you have significantly more camps that are essentially dedicated to sexual exploitation and slavery than are dedicated to extermination or major concentration camps, et cetera. And I remember when I first saw this, these numbers were really a revelation to me because historically, in terms of the common narrative regarding the Holocaust and the way that victims were persecuted, sexual violence tended to be underemphasized or not acknowledged as a particular threat that was posed in particular to women once they were ensnared within this concentration camp system. I can share after the talk on the chat the actual URL for that if any of you want to return to that chart. But what I'll say for now is that while I'm not going to be elaborating explicitly on sexual violence, that was obviously a real threat. And the reason that I didn't want to take more time to elaborate on that is because within the field of Holocaust scholarship, a lot of times when the Holocaust is approached from the perspective of gender, gender is kind of a stand-in for women, and specifically the focus has become sexual violence, which is somewhat problematic because although that was a real threat and a reality for many women, it's not the only aspect from the perspective of gender that is worth considering. So I'm happy to answer any questions regarding that aspect during the Q&A when we have time, but I want to move more generally to essentially what the intention of genocide is. And the intention of genocide is essentially to destroy an entire group of people. And you know, actually, it was at a talk that I attended some years ago at the KHC. I remember it was a Bosnian survivor who was female. And she said this line that always stuck with me that I wanted to share. She said, if you want to kill a plant, you have to kill its roots. And that to me really demonstrated the inherently gendered nature of this form of mass violence, because essentially destruction of families is an essential core feature of genocide. And so what you see is once victims are ensnared within the concentration camp system, they're separated based on sex. So men and women are separated. They're separated from their children, separated from loved ones, family members, things like that. And so you really see this kind of rupturing of the family unit. And as we'll see, this systematic targeting of sex roles, where there will be forcible sterilizations and other specific Nazi policies that will attempt to eradicate for the Jewish victims an ability to continue reproducing, for instance, that I'll elaborate on shortly. But the other side of this coin, also that's not always known, is that actually of those German Jews who were able to survive during the reign of the Nazi regime, 95% of the German Jews who survived were intermarried. So essentially what this means is that this was a German Jewish person who was married to a Gentile or a non-Jewish person, for instance. And so what this demonstrates is that family could serve to protect a person from persecution depending on the status of other family members, for instance. So the takeaway here is that the threats posed to women versus men, given their variations in sex and sex roles, and also gender-based expectancies that we'll elaborate on shortly, is going to lead to variation in actual experiences. And this isn't intended to imply that one sex had it better or worse than the other. It's more to allow us to deconstruct and examine from a perspective of identity, right? And sex and gender is a very powerful part, as is whether or not a person is Jewish, for instance, or what ethnicity or religious affiliation they have. These are all aspects of our identity. And those aspects of our identity are going to strongly influence and shape the experiences that we have living under a regime like this. Another oft quoted kinds of mantra here regarding sex and gender as it pertains to the Holocaust is different horrors, same hell. And that always stuck with me as well, because it's recognizing again that it's not like we're saying one group had it better or worse than the other. It's just acknowledging that what you experienced or what the particular threats were oftentimes would be mediated or filtered by whether you were a man or a woman, for instance. And to kind of break this down further, the takeaway here is that the genocide was not gender neutral, and virtually no genocide is gender neutral. If we think of our own lives, virtually anything that we experience is not gender neutral. It's mediated through whether we're male or female, right? And so quote that I wanted to share from a scholar, this scholar writes, gender was a factor in the destruction of the Jewish people. Of the Jewish population, as Jewish women linked to the race struggle of the regime were targeted not only as Jews, but as Jewish women because they carried the next generation of Jews. So they were targeted not just based on race, but based on their sex and potential for maternity or as mothers. And this is really getting at the kind of intersectionality of what we're trying to examine right now, which is that essentially, because of their sex roles, women had a particular target, Jewish women in particular, Roma women, women that are part of the different groups that are being persecuted, they are seen as being a threat to the regime to the extent that they have the ability to procreate and create the next generation, if you will, of Jewish offspring, let's say. And for a regime whose intention is to eradicate a group of people, that's perceived as threatening. So that's where you get forced sterilization policies, for instance. Jewish women and Roma women in particular were targeted for these coercive, forcible sterilizations, forced abortions, sexual humiliation, which both men and women in the camps experienced this. They were oftentimes stripped naked. They were shaved. They were humiliated for the way their bodies looked and things like that. But the threats that accompanied the being stripped naked oftentimes varied. The threat of sexual violence was oftentimes more pronounced for women than it was for men, for instance. I'm sorry, everyone. I just have to put a pause for one moment. Sorry about that. I apologize. I was just, my dog was acting out and I had to put him aside. I apologize for that. Okay. And then another thing, so I was talking about these forcible sterilizations, abortions, things like that. it was also difficult to survive once you were ensnared in the concentration camp system as a woman, if you were pregnant or if you had a young infant or child, for instance. And so more Jewish women are also believed to have been deported to the camps and killed than Jewish men. And the reason for this is at the start of the kind of rise of Nazism within Germany, there was this sense that Jewish men were more explicitly under threat because they were being targeted by the regime. And there was this sense that they were perceived as being potentially more threatening, as they were perceived as the ones that could potentially resist or fight against the rising Nazi threat. And so for a lot of families who were being targeted at this time, they allocated a lot of their resources explicitly to allowing their men to go into hiding or sending them overseas, procuring visas for them to leave the country and things like that. So what ends up happening is that once it becomes clear that the Nazi threat is not specific to one sex, but that everyone within a family is under threat, a lot of males within families are already gone. And so what ends up happening is not only are women more likely to be deported, but when they are deported, they're also less likely to be perceived as useful to the regime. So if we go back to the chart that I believe Dr. Cohen also shared the URL of how you can access it later, 30 to 40,000% of the camps within the system were forced labor camps. And so essentially, once you were a part of the concentration camp system, your best bet of surviving would be to be perceived as useful to the regime. And women and children almost immediately were targeted because they were seen as weaker and unable to perform the rigors within these work camps. And so pregnant women in particular, mothers of small children, they were consistently labeled as quote unquote incapable of work. They were sent to killing centers. Camp officials often included them in the first groups that essentially were gassed and killed. On the other hand, you also have responsibilities of unmarried young women, where essentially their role, and now we're talking about gender roles. Now we're talking about what are the expectations that are placed on men versus women within a given society or culture. For unmarried younger women, oftentimes they stayed behind to take care of their parents or elderly in-laws. In the case of unmarried women, it would be their parents more often, but for married women, a lot of times it would also be in-laws or other elderly relatives. And so near the end of the war, actually, it was mainly women who were left in Germany, and the final transports to different camps, they were almost entirely women, and a lot of them were older women. And a striking number of memoirs and testimonials basically tell of women who refused to abandon their mothers or their elderly kin and essentially were killed with them. So I would actually argue that this is, to a large extent, really resonant with present day gender roles as well. Women continue to be the primary caregivers within a lot of cultures, including ours. Like, the pandemic has really amplified this, where, you know, women, the burden of, you know, taking care of kids during homeschooling, who's responsible for making sure mom and dad get vaccinated or grandparents get registered and things like that. A lot of that is falling disproportionately to women. So even though obviously the stakes are higher when we're talking about living under a regime that's engaging in mass violence and killings, the kind of underlying expectations for men versus women in the society that then kind of shape the experience that you have within the regime, that's actually really resonant. And we can kind of point to gender expectancies that we're all experiencing today. I can elaborate more regarding persecution or victimization and how that varied based on whether one was male or female. But just to kind of offer us a wider scope and consideration, I wanted to briefly consider both resistance and rescue efforts, and then kind of close with talking about women's roles as enablers or perpetrators. So let me share a little anecdote here. I'm currently working on looking at the psychology of bystander behavior. So a lot of what I'm sharing right now comes from a book that I'm working on. But one anecdote that I wanted to share with all of you is about a French psychiatrist who is female. Her name was Adelaide Hautval, and she was actually deported to Auschwitz because she had insisted on wearing a yellow star in sympathy with other Jews. This was actually an act of resistance or defiance of Nazi orders. And so for this act of resistance, she was deported just as other victims of the regime were. She was approached by an SS doctor who was male that said to her, "Cannot you see that these people are different from you?" And her response was, "There are several other people different from me, starting with you." So she drew this very kind of clear line in terms of, I'm not participating as a psychiatrist with these forcible sterilizations. I'm not participating in this larger system that's systematically targeting and, you know, discriminating against this group of people. And that solidarity got her sent to one of the camps. And I use this as a specific example of a demonstration of resistance. And there's also important examples of rescue where essentially bystanders, individuals who were not exclusively from any group that was being targeted, but who could potentially lose status or worse if they helped those groups, they basically put their own livelihood or potentially lives or families at risk to offer help or aid to Jewish people, for instance. And, you know, it's a lot of times when we approach the Holocaust, we approach it from this kind of binary way where we think, okay, people living within this system, they were either victims or they were perpetrators. And we don't realize that there's this entire middle ground that's constituted by bystanders, and any bystander could potentially at any moment become a resistor or a rescuer depending on the decisions that they made. Now, generally speaking, the research that looks at rescuer behavior and what qualities defined or characteristics were common among individuals who engaged in rescue, there's no evidence to suggest that sex or gender would necessarily tilt in either direction. A lot of the qualities are outside of constructs of sex and gender. They're more personality or situationally based or status based or class based or things like that. But generally speaking, a lot of times there's this kind of underestimate of the role that women played as rescuers or resistors because, you know, so much of what we know about the world around us is embedded in stories, and stories can be very compelling. And, you know, storytellers, their rhetoric is also, you know, we listen, we want to learn and things like that. And a lot of the kind of standard stories that we have regarding rescue and resistance, the protagonist or the main characters are males. And we kind of associate heroism with male characteristics. Although that stereotype actually isn't entirely true. Women were just as likely to engage in resistance and rescue efforts as men. In fact, women had leadership roles within resistance groups and oftentimes also risked their own lives to engage in heroic rescue. Now, something that women had working for them that men didn't is that they were less likely to be perceived as threatening to the regime. So it's possible that women could go undetected, or their femininity, if you will, could serve as a disguise that could enable them to engage in rescue or resistance efforts in a way that wouldn't open them to the same level of scrutiny as men, for instance. Just one example of the kind of power of stories and how oftentimes characterizations how oftentimes characterizations of heroes kind of tilt towards males is Schindler's List is a really compelling story regarding a very significant effort of rescue, but almost entirely lost in that depiction is the role that his wife actually played in helping to facilitate the rescue of upwards of 1,300 Jews. Like, she's virtually non-existent in the film. So that's just kind of one pop cultural example of this. As we wind down, I want to look at the one category that is perhaps even more taboo to consider because it defies our traditional stereotypes of masculinity and femininity, which is looking at the roles that women might have played in facilitating, enabling, or even perpetrating mass violence and genocidal acts. And, if we think about constructions of masculinity and femininity, what we're really talking about is what qualities or behaviors do we associate within a society or culture as being male versus female? And this is on that gender side of sex and gender. And for both sexes, there is a performative aspect to demonstrating or expressing our respective genders. So in other words, we deliberately engage in behaviors that demonstrate or expresses, see, I'm a woman, or see, I'm a man. And if we think about the traditional characteristics that are associated with masculinity in most cultures and societies, things like competitiveness, things like being independent, dominance, strength, these types of qualities, if they're amplified and taken to an extreme, which is oftentimes referred to as hyper-masculine norms. So hyper-masculine norms is you take these traditional or stereotypical qualities we associate with being male and we amplify or exaggerate them. From this perspective, one could actually look at mass violence and genocide more generally as the ultimate performance of hypermasculine norms, the ultimate demonstration within a culture or society of hypermasculine norms. The Nazi regime was a very male-dominant, patriarchal regime, meaning male-dominated, male-run regime that was promoting fairly stereotypical or standard ideas of what men versus women should do. And from the perspective of this performative aspect of masculinity and femininity, it sounds so vulgar, to reflect upon today, but this was actually a practice that was commonly done during this period. SS officers, guards at camps, they would actually bring their wives or girlfriends to essentially show off to them what was happening in the camps. It also was not uncommon for high-ranking officials to bring their wives or girlfriends to sites of mass shootings to essentially have them visit and have them show, see, this is what we're doing with the Jewish problem. This is how I'm contributing, to this race and space policy. And that to me really demonstrates that performative aspect for both sexes, the male as, as actor, as having agency, as showing off, as demonstrating, and then the female as passive, as viewing, as spectator, as praising, as supporting cast, things like that. But even beyond this, if we look at the numbers, you might actually be surprised to hear that there were female auxiliaries in the German armed forces. And by the end of the war, the numbers approached 500,000. And of these 500,000 German women that were part of the armed forces, close to 4,000 of them, the number is 3,700, they actually served as guards in the Nazi concentration camps. And that really defies our stereotypes. There are even documented cases of particular female guards that were very sadistic, who engaged in beatings and things like that, targeting other women within the camps, etc. But here's the other side of the coin. In the same way that women might have been able to move somewhat less under suspicion than men regarding resistance or rescue efforts, female perpetrators in the aftermath, after the war, with the liberation of the camps that would come at the end of the war, they were also more likely to move around undetected as former perpetrators, because that really wasn't on the radar of the Allied powers. In fact, female camp guards had little to fear in the aftermath of the war. And total, only 77 of female, like the number 77, not even a percentage, just 77 former female camp guards stood on any kind of trial. And there were documented cases of women perpetrators who were found guilty and who were hanged. They were essentially killed for their participation, but this was less common than what you saw regarding male perpetrators. And I have to share, in terms of kinds of gender stereotypes, when Dr. Cohen and I were first talking about my developing this talk for the KHC, I kind of had my own blind spot regarding the role of women as perpetrators. You know, she had to explicitly say to me, do not ignore this aspect in your talk, which was very eye-opening to me that, you know, as someone who's been investigating and examining deeply bystander behavior, that I was also kind of ignoring this other part of the story because of maybe my own biases regarding what's the template of perpetrator that we think about when we think about mass violence and genocide, for instance. In addition to actual perpetration, now I should mention, part of the reason why we might neglect the role that women played is that the Nazi regime was very male dominated, and there weren't a lot of high ranking politicians within the system who were female. However, nonetheless, it doesn't mean that they weren't participating or enabling facilitation of the genocidal policy. Scholars, in addition to what I just discussed regarding actual perpetration, they also use this term second tier agents of terror for women who either in professional positions or within the positions within the domestic sphere, essentially enabled the types of atrocities that we saw. So for instance, secretaries to high-ranking Nazi officials, supportive wives of SS officers. There was also this really kind of grotesque juxtaposition that in a lot of these camps, like for instance at Auschwitz, so you have the horrors of the camps and the kind of restricted access and killings that are happening and things like that. But then almost immediately adjacent to the camp, you have these grounds of high-ranking officials whose wives and children and families are essentially living right next door to where they're working, and where they're working is essentially a death camp. And so, you know, the wives, even their children, they're very privy to the realities of what's happening within that camp. You also had nurses, and as I mentioned, the example of that one female doctor who also was a resistor that participated in these euthanasia programs, the medical experiments, which oftentimes also included these forced sterilization practices, coercive medical procedures, and things like that. So I know it's a mouthful. We've covered a lot. The takeaway is that the larger system constructed by the Nazi regime created this kind of institution, if you will, that was promoting mass violence and genocide, and that was also transmitting values regarding appropriate roles or expectations for respective males versus women within this larger system. And I think it's important to deconstruct both men and women's experiences because it offers a multidimensional approach that enables us hopefully to more insightfully kind of understand the experiences under the regime. But I think also what it spotlights, the spotlight also recognizes that there's greater complexity that we would think when we try to imagine the experiences of individuals who are living under this regime. And a lot of times what happens is the more we're immersed or exposed to things, it triggers more questions maybe than it does answers. So I do want to leave time for the Q&A portion. So I'll just take this moment to thank Dr. Cohen for the invitation and to thank all of you for participating. meeting, and I look forward to hearing what kinds of questions you might have for me.
Thank you so much, Dr. Alai. This has really been very powerful, and I most appreciate your talking about the different ways identity, race, gender, religion intersect. And it reminds me of Kimberly Crenshaw's work on intersectionality and looking at how, in the case of Black women in the United States, how they're discriminated against doubly, not just because they're women, but because they're Black, and how do those two things come together. Before we go into the Q&A, I wanted to just take a few minutes to show everyone and share with you the online exhibition for the KHC's online exhibition on the concentration camps, and I'm trying to find that right now. Here we are. I will share with everyone the link to the site. When we developed this exhibition, there were two parts. And the first was to take note of the fact that there were 44,000 different kinds of concentration camps in the Nazi system. And what we wanted to make sure of was to get across two points. The first is that this is a system of incarceration. And as Dr. Alai mentioned, oftentimes in the narrative, we're focusing on one particular aspect, and that is extermination camps. But this system begins with arrests. It begins with detention centers. It starts in local police stations. And as the system of terror and murder and deportation continues, the system gets bigger, it gets more complex. We start to have things like concentration camps, labor camps, gender-specific camps, brothels, through extermination camps. And we also wanted to focus on displaced person camps after the war, as well as the death marches. The second part of this exhibition is to focus on the complete group of victims who were targeted. It's 6 million Jewish people and millions more, and that includes Polish people, Roma and Sinti, homosexuals, people with disabilities, social outcasts, Jehovah's Witnesses, and pretty much anyone conceived as a threat to the Nazi regime. This exhibition is organized into different sections. I'll go very briefly through a few of them. In the charts section, you'll find one of the charts that Dr. Alai referenced regarding type and number of camps. We also have charts that focus on the estimated deaths. You can see in this particular chart, Jewish people were the overwhelming group of people who were targeted, but Soviet citizens and POVs were also focused on, and it's a huge range. You can go through these charts by the number of prisoners and survivors, number of deaths in the Nazi extermination camps, of which there were six. And what Dr. Alai mentioned is that there were hundreds of brothels, and we're going to talk about that in a moment, and causes of death. The bulk of the exhibition lives in what we call the text section. It's split up into five sections: the Nazi strategy of concentrating people, early Nazi incarceration sites. We get into creation of ghettos and expansion of camps. Yes, we consider ghettos to be a form of concentration. We also discuss mass incarceration, extermination, and then ultimately ending with death marches, liberation, and displaced persons camp. You'll also find in this section an extensive bibliography, as well as an epilogue talking about the impact of this system in the post-war years. The images section, we have extensive imagery for each of the different sections, along with captions and historical information. Before the pandemic in February of 2020, we worked with 13 of the survivors who are very connected for a long time to the Kupferberg Holocaust Center. We recorded their testimonies on video. And in this exhibition, we've created three original films. You can find the rest of everyone's testimonies on our website, which I'll share for you. The centerpiece of this exhibition is a map that we constructed that shows a selection of the number of camps, but rather than focus on Europe's pre-war borders, or the borders in Europe during World War II, we've overlaid it against a contemporary map of Europe. And this is especially important for faculty and students to kind of be able to situate where things were. This map includes dots not only associated with different territory between the Nazis and the Allies, but also major ghettos, major concentration camps, satellite camps, and so forth. You'll find, click out of this, a study guide that we've created, which is a separate library guide that includes not only parts of the exhibition, but it also includes additional elements in terms of doing research, additional books that you can look at. We also worked and were grateful to work with Nicholas Voxman, who created a very important book, KL, A History of the Nazi Concentration Camps. He also worked on a very extensive website on the concentration camps. And rather than try to incorporate everything into our exhibition, we wanted to link because we felt this was really critical. Finally, in the coming weeks, there will be a printed catalog that you can find. So I'm going to stop sharing the screen. And Dr. Alai, I just again wanted to thank you. And one of the questions that came up, and I'm just sort of scowling here, is I just wanted to go back for a moment and talk about sexual violence. One of the things that came up when we were fact-checking the exhibition with the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum is we were talking about whether brothels are brothels or are they rape camps. And of all the things that we got feedback on, it was that. That in fact, we shouldn't be talking about them as rape camps. We should only be framing them as brothels. And this is also consistent with thinking about brothels and having sort of an understanding of like, what are brothels? Are these voluntary places of sexual intercourse, or are these coercive spaces? And I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about that. And also just to ask, when we're talking about brothels, are these standalone places? Were they also placed inside the different kinds of concentration camps?
Yeah, I wasn't sure if you were going to bring that up or not, because I had a discussion with one of your curators and he shared that with me, and that was very eye-opening for me. And so I don't know if you recall, I started with saying brothel, but then I also said potentially a site for sexual slavery. So, you know, and I don't know how to answer that question because I don't know if it's been properly investigated. It reminds me of the quote unquote comfort women, right? And I know that the KHC has had, you know, exhibits in the past about that as well. These kind of euphemisms or frames that we use and the way that language oftentimes can serve to disguise the true intention of what's being done, for instance. The sexual violence piece in particular is so fraught and taboo. And I remember that you and I were having a discussion about this and how to approach it. And, you know, I think you said something about, you know, women didn't disclose this in their interviews as survivor testimony. And I said, well, nobody asked them, right? So there was almost this sense of like, and, you know, there's such silencing and there's such taboos, even today, even post Me Too, in disclosing if we've been the victim of any form of sexual assault or violence. And I would imagine in the 1930s, 30s and 40s, this was even more pronounced. And so there was a lot of silencing and, you know, meaningful silences or implications of stuff without coming out and saying it. But then also, sex was oftentimes bartered as well. And so there's this kind of, you know, notion of like what constitutes consent, right? If you're a woman who's left to survive on your own and you have a child and one of your neighbors or one of these officers in the territory where you've been occupied has access to food, but he's also been hitting on you and clear, I mean, like, you know, so there's like this barter system of you give him sex and he gives you food. But then even that, like how consensual is that if this is a necessary feature of your survival, for instance? And what happened in the aftermath is that we didn't want to have conversations regarding how women were victimized, but communities were very quick to stigmatize women who were perceived as having to in some way benefited or gotten favors by occupiers because of their sexuality. So women were kind of in this double bind that you couldn't disclose or you couldn't seek out any support. But at the same time, if it was perceived that, oh, you know, in occupied France, she was one of the favored, you know, protected women in the community by this SS officer. You know, after the liberation, a lot of these women were thrown into the streets. Their heads were shaved as an emblem of their essentially collaborating. But is that really, you know, collaboration if you're trying to feed your kids or if you're hiding people and you're trying to curry favor so that they don't scrutinize you in the same way that they would scrutinize? So I guess my you know, ineloquent way of answering that is that it's such a fraught topic and it's hard to know with certainty. Now, in regards to the brothels, I actually wasn't even aware of this until I saw the charts myself. And that's why it was such a revelation for me. So I actually don't know how those operated in the camps. I can't answer that question of whether they were standalone or whether they were an extension of the larger camps, for instance. That's actually something I was totally unaware of until I was actually exposed to your exhibit. So I'm grateful for that, that's something new that I learned about.
Well, I think it's important because one of the things that you've also mentioned is sort of the hegemonic memory of the Holocaust. We're thinking about men, and I don't even know if we're always thinking it's men in particular, but what voices are silenced? And you very eloquently talked about the silencing of women's experiences, the silencing of the diversity of experiences. And I think also the thing that kind of really resonated with me is different horrors, same hell. One of the attendees mentioned, and I just want to refer everyone to Dr. Wendy Lauer. She wrote a book, Hitler's Furies. She's a senior Holocaust scholar, and she recently did a talk with the Illinois Holocaust Museum. And really, she's talking about women perpetrators and how typical scholarship has ignored the role. And I think that that's really, really critical as we were going through this exhibition as well. We were learning. We were challenging our own assumptions, but also looking at this through a new lens and the lens of contemporary life. I also want to mention, I shared in the chat, a lecture that we hosted 2 weeks ago with Dr. Danny Sexton. He's associate professor of English at Queensborough Community College. His talk focused on LGBTQI+ people in the camps. And one of the elements we discussed in there was also the role of gender and sexuality and the brothels. So I encourage everyone to take a look at that. I was wondering, we have a question, Dr. Lai, could you speak to the cooperation of the Nazis with the women in the occupied populations?
Yeah, that's such a fraught area as well, because there's this kind of overarching question of how much agency or choice did women have who were in occupied territories? But I was actually also reading the other night the flip of this. There were German women who had more power and who essentially were heads of their households after the men had left. And they would oftentimes use that power in coercive way against other men in the communities. So it's interesting to think about power is oftentimes gendered, but the traditional way of thinking of power is that males are the one with powers and that women are the ones that are victimized. But what happens when that dynamic is also uprooted and it goes in the other direction? There were documented instances of German women essentially using their higher status to procure favors in a coercive way against men that they were attracted to. And I think is also a really taboo subject to consider as well, the extent to which men might have been victimized within this system as well. But it depended on the country that was being occupied. It depended upon the status of individuals within the given cultures, the level of influence that, family members or other people within the communities might have had. There were so many other aspects, and that kind of returns back to that intersectionality piece that you highlighted. Age is a really important factor as well. Class is a really important factor that we didn't get to elaborate on as much in depth as I would have liked to have seen, for instance, but there's a lot of different features of identity that kind of come together to inform and mediate the experience that individuals had during this time. And I didn't even get to kind of sexual orientation and that type of thing as well that you were talking about in terms of LGBTQ, which we know they were also a targeted group within the regime. So there's that layer as well.
You know, it's interesting that you say that, again, talking about issues of race and gender and class and status in that lecture. And these are very related topics. We did them as separate lectures, but we could have certainly talked about them together. It was also finding space to talk about voices, right? In that case, when we talk about gay people in the camps, we're mostly talking about men, not gay women, and certainly not people that were trans. And so one of the things that comes up a lot now in the scholarship and in discussions is using, again, as I said this before, a contemporary lens of the way we view the world now to kind of see what might we be missing or overlooking. Before we close, I had another question for you. In terms of educators and students who are on the call, what do you recommend as a way to kind of begin to think about this topic?
That's a great question. I noticed that you had a quote in the exhibit from Primo Levi. I think that, you know, he was an Auschwitz survivor, for those of you who aren't familiar with him. And I think that for me, when I was an undergraduate student, an entry point for me in terms of my own Holocaust education was memoirs and testimonials. I think that that's a really powerful way. If the circumstances were different right now in terms of the pandemic, we would have the opportunity to be meeting with our survivors, for instance, which is a great opportunity that our students will have once we're back on campus fully. But I think that it's always important because the thing, you know, when I first learned about the Holocaust, it can be very overwhelming. And it's kind of like, you know, how do you wrap your head around the millions and millions of victims? And a lot of times, in order to kind of humanize or in a more resonant, relatable way, understand what it was like to live under the conditions, it's really powerful to read about a person's experiences. And that's one other thing that I'm glad you asked this, because I wanted to share. You know, from the perspective of silencing voices versus who's the voice of the, you know, Holocaust survivor, traditionally and historically, the voices have been male. And so, and you know, the voices have been of a certain type of male, right? So heterosexual, you know, in a lot of ways, kind of, you know, reinforcing those set privileges that also permeate our culture today. I would definitely recommend Primo Levi, Survival in Auschwitz. And, you know, he was such an eloquent writer, and his experiences really resonated with me. But I also want to recommend specifically a female memoirist. Her name was Ruth Kluger. And I'm drawing a blank on what the name of the memoir, Still Alive, Ruth Kluger, and she survived Auschwitz. And what's really unique about her experiences is that she was still a girl when she was deported with her mom, but she eventually ended up lying about her age. And so she was able to work even though she was a younger girl. But she talks very eloquently about, from a developmental perspective, for someone like her who was still developing and hadn't had a full identity yet or known a reality outside of being targeted as a Jewish girl, that this really kind of transformed her identity and how she developed. And she actually compares her experiences to Levi. She's like, when Primo Levi was, you know, deported to Auschwitz from Italy, he was a fully formed man who had experiences outside of being victimized because of his Jewish identity. She didn't have that benefit. And so her perspective, not only as a woman who survived, but also as someone who, from the earliest recollections of her childhood in Vienna, could recall being made to feel different because of her Jewish identity, it's a really eye-opening and compelling story. And I actually wasn't exposed to her until I started to do this work, I want to say, as a graduate student. So, you know, I was exposed to the standard Night, Diary of Anne Frank, and things like that. Not to say that those aren't meaningful books, but that's just a certain type of testimonial, but it doesn't speak to kind of the range and diversity of experiences that survivors had.
And I'm really glad that you also talk about just the diversity of text to read. It's one of the things that I think is so overwhelming. I'm noticing in the chat, you know, so many people are just bringing up conversations and books and articles. And, you know, often it's there's the scholarly realm, there's the survivor realm. And so We're going to close out. It's 1 o'clock. I want to thank you so much, Dr. Alai, for your conversation today and really bringing to light so many different aspects of women and gender in the Nazi concentration camp system, but also for bringing up even more questions for us to ponder. I want to thank everyone for watching today. You can find more information about the Kupferberg Holocaust Center on our website, which I've shared with you in the chat. We hope you all stay safe and be well. Thank you.
Thank you for the invitation. And I'll also just share with everyone, if you have any follow-up questions, I'm faculty here at QCC. Send me an email. Some of you, you have me in your classes, so you know how to reach me. But I'm happy to continue the conversation in other avenues as we're able to. So thank you for the invitation and stay safe, everyone. Take care.